The music of Beethoven has this an incredible capacity of making us grow. We grow through the sonatas, we grow through the variations, we go through each movement. Each motif is making us think again. Beethoven was the first composer who was publicly verbal in the social surrounding, historical surrounding that he was going through. He was an idealist in a way that he thought culture, art, and philosophy, science could make our world a much better place.
It has always been, let's say, kind of difficult to get to terms with this music, just because it requires exactness in phrasing and in rhythmical patterns and in rendering. It's so, let's say, ruthless. It doesn't leave you any margin for error. We always think, as Beethoven, okay, you have to play in tempo, it has to be rigorous, it has to be almost sacred, but it sometimes, yes, but not always, and many times it's actually humorous, many times it's making jokes. He wrote on a cadenza for the fourth concerto, cadenza senza cadere, so without falling. So he was full of humor, full of life, temperamental, and all of that can just burst out in his music. And we, as interpreters, have to do it, have to render it also by changing tempos and by all the means of expression that have to be restricted in a way that they are logical, but not in an over restriction on yourself.
The performances are different every time, especially with this, such great pieces as Beethoven sonatas and Beethoven chamber music with opus numbers are each one of them great, great, great masterpieces. And I think somehow, you know, we've been playing these pieces for the past 20, 30 years, but I really honestly think that we grow with them and they have the substance to make us grow, understand him better. In a way, these pieces are portraits of Beethoven himself when he was young, and when he was going through the crisis with Fidelio in the middle period and the late period, I think, when we know that we begin to enter the late period with these two Beethoven Opus 102 sonatas. It's just not only personally significant, but also historically important too. To be playing the complete five sonatas at the Goslar Music Festival in Rammelsberg, it was an absolutely fascinating experience. I mean, to be playing in these old mines and then turn into concert hall, which had magnificent acoustic, by the way. It was a great, great experience.
Someone likes challenges. So now we play the project in two concerts, which is what usually is done. But I recall that once we even played it in one afternoon. So one program right after the other, I think we had 1 hour in between. And this was really challenging because this music needs your entire attention on each note or on each phrase. Each silence is so charged with significance.
To be back here at Holy World Music Room to be playing these complete Beethoven works and with Philippe's introductory talk and then Laura's short lecture is adding the dimension of the project. It's absolutely fantastic to be working with these two academics, and they bring the historical, social, and academic side to the musical side that I and Enrico bring along with our instruments. There's some moments in there's such an incredible conflict within the voices, and then that's exactly why he's trying to write in the music. His own inner conflict is totally written within the notes, no? Don't you find?
Yes, I think so, and in the way that themes get exchanged.
Yes, yes.
And that it sort of pushing both players, all parts, to do more. Mm. So I think you do get a sense of that actually being written in. And I wonder whether that's also reflected in him, certainly with the earlier sonatas, being the performer as well. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I think it's about 1815 that he makes his final appearance as a performer. Mm-hmm. And
with the Archduke trio.
Yeah, so then that opens up the opportunity for him to maybe conceive of his music in a slightly more abstract way, maybe less physical way, I don't know. But there's certainly changes in the amount of risk he's prepared to take, the kinds of risks he takes in the later music. Yes.
One reads the Rossini's encounter when he had an appointment with Beethoven, and then he didn't show up, and he goes to his house and he sees Beethoven totally on the floor with the legs of the piano totally cut off, his Broadwood piano on his floor, and then he's lying on the floor with the whole, his entire body in contact with the floor, and he's playing piano, trying to feel the vibration. Mm-hmm. And just that testimony is just absolutely touching, you know, and then it makes you try to understand through the vibration of the music what he tried to mean through these motifs and then the structure. Well, I have recorded the Beethoven sonatas and variations a number of years ago. And my playing definitely has changed. I feel much closer emotionally, spiritually to Beethoven. That kind of understanding, sometimes that kind of struggle, that kind of connection with his own soul, and through the sorrow, the joy arrives in the sonatas is something that I definitely can identify much better personally and instrumentally as well.
It's very peculiar that he was deaf, but the sound word he had in his head was going beyond what were the possibilities of the instruments at the time. For sure, the possibilities of the fortepiano at the time. So what happens is that he has an incredible reach, color world, and he gets it out no matter what is the technical challenge for the player. He really didn't care. It's just he wants to create this sound world, and no matter what, it's your business. He said to this famous line to Schuppanzig, the violinist, "Oh, I don't care about you, you know, I see the Geist, you know, the spirit is talking to me, and what do I care how you play it?" So this is in fact the big challenge, to go over the hurdles and see the final message.
He says he's going to challenge the cellist Linka mm-hmm. in these sonatas. He's going to make it difficult for him.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know that letter. So I would love always, to read that.
Yes, and actually you do get a strong sense, and I really liked the way in your performances that actually that sense of cellist and pianist sparring with each other and challenging each other and saying, well, I can do this, can you? Mm-hmm. It's something that I think comes through in your performances, but in the sonatas as well. And I think that's because they are actually dependent on these quite secure, friendly collaborations. Mm. But that doesn't mean there isn't an amount of teasing mm. and joking there as well.
Played numerous times the sonatas, the trios, and then some of the quartets, and of course enjoy playing as a guest in some of the Beethoven symphonies, in some of the orchestras. Each of those experiences nourishes my understanding of Beethoven sonatas, Beethoven's music, and Beethoven's spirit. And then to be recording Neumark, we really did probably more than any other recording, is to really play as a live concert. Every note was as if we were playing our last concert almost. And we wanted that spirituality in the music of Beethoven. And I think the result is quite satisfying.
Well, recording is always a fixed point in what you're doing, so you try to achieve as much as you can beforehand just to have the clearest possible ideas about what you want to do, about how you want to shape the pieces, what importance you want to give to the elements. I mean, in these sonatas you start from a quite early Beethoven and you get to the late one, so the span is very important, and also the way at seeing the piece it's really different.
My concern, my preoccupation, my obsession was that the listeners would feel the inner struggle, the transcendent moments in the later sonatas, or the absolute virtuosity of the younger sonatas. There's human aspects that we wanted to bring into the recording, that the listeners would feel the vibration of inner Beethoven himself. Ever since, I think maybe 8-9 years ago, we've been playing sonatas, many of the programs, and then one of the most extraordinary musicians, extraordinary pianist, always seeking new ideas, always trying to understand in depth.
I think he's a musician for the stage. So when he's on stage, he really senses the moment and he really has the feel for the timing, for the atmosphere, and that makes him really a special musician alongside with his beautiful cantabile tone and his going from pianissimo, really so delicate, to full vibrant singing tone. So I think this is, especially these aspects, so the timing and the way of suddenly stopping the music or taking it anew, sometimes even abruptly, his flamboyant musicianship, I think, makes a collaboration really enjoyable and also stimulating every time.
Understanding the music, Beethoven's inner world is the more important than any other composers, I would say. And then it was an absolute joy to work on this project with Enrico.
The Eroica Symphony changes the course of history, mm-hmm. and the late music is something that is going beyond what was imagined. Mm-hmm. Actually, it continues to be challenging through to the 20th century. I mean, it continues to be challenging mm-hmm. today. Mm-hmm. Beethoven in the 1820s is somebody who has, in some ways, retreated from society for personal reasons. Mm-hmm. The musicians that are popular are precisely people like Rossini, mm-hmm. writing operas that are very, very different from the type of music that Beethoven is producing. So there is a sense that he's out of time, mm-hmm. or his time will come, which is what he predicts.
Yes.
So I think we can see him as reflecting the political and social situation in which he's in, but I think we now hear this music as signaling beyond, and I think that's another way in which we think of it as being spiritual mm. as well. Mm-hmm.
After the late quartet premieres, and then he had received, you know, not so positive comments, and he said, "My music is not for you, so for the future generations." And in fact, by writing this kind of music, he actually opened doors to many composers after him, who wrote not only beautiful lines and beautifully structured pieces, but they actually conveyed human feelings within the music. You know, that was the most important part, you know, human feelings. And what is most important with Beethoven is there's always ultimately hope in his music. That's what I really admire, that even throughout the whole life that he's lived, the struggles that he had to overcome, it's thanks to God, religion, and also the classical philosophers, and through the music, that he always was able to convey hopefulness. The hope was the most important part of Beethoven's composition, ultimately.
For him, an artist should show the way to the people. Should not just be, okay, I do what I like and I produce sound, but it should be really like, you know, like a tyrant, we could say, in the old Greece. So he should make the people move towards a certain direction in the moral world also. So he felt this responsibility, and that's why his music is always so poignant, so full of good and healthy message for everybody. Thank you.
Beethoven continues to inspire us, and he left these monumental pieces to improve our lives, to improve our societies, to heighten our ideals. And I hope our recordings and our concerts will inspire you. Thank you.